Hello Ron, we are today at the Military History Museum of the Bundeswehr in Dresden, and this is Jens Wehner.
Hello.
And we will take a look at the Marder of the German Bundeswehr and at the BMP-2 of the Red Army. Now, this is not a direct technical comparison of those vehicles, but more on the general concepts for both armies and doctrine and everything around this.
Yeah, so if we look at this vehicle, at this APC, we see it's quite huge for an APC, even by modern standards. It has a great height and it's armed with a 2 cm meshing cannon, which has a penetration of roughly 50 millimeters on 500 meters at a frontal plate. Its engine is 600 horsepower and its weight, and this is special about this APC, the German Marder, it's 33 tons. So this means a lot. Wow. Yeah, it's like a T-34-85 in World War II, so I think it's really quite heavy. And the question is, why is this? And if you look at the development of this tank, you have to go into the roots of German APC development after the war, which is quite interesting also for World War II things, World War II stuff, because the veterans of the Wehrmacht were officers in the then now Bundeswehr, and they discussed about their experiences with the Panzergrenadiers. And there was a discussion, how much should the vehicle be in combat? And there was one faction that said, okay, the vehicle should fight with the tanks or maybe as a tank itself. So there was really a debate about a fusion between tanks and Panzergrenadiers. And there was another faction who said, no, it should be more or less a battle taxi.
And transport vehicle, just drop us off.
Yeah. And in the end, one problem was the anticipated atomic war with all the nuclear bombs, how to survive. And of course, in a nuclear war, Panzergrenadiers who were under the hatch in a fully armored vehicle had an advantage. And so it was decided to buy a fully armed and fully armored vehicle. And this was the so-called HS-30. Which was not a very successful vehicle for several reasons. It was not successful, and so at the beginning of the 60s, they decided to develop a new vehicle, and it should have a weight of roughly 15 tons.
Almost. Almost, you got it almost.
And 15 tons, as you can see, 33 tons at least, because they had every time a new idea what should put in any features, and in the end, over 10 years, so it was, let's say, nearly the whole decade of the 1960s as development time, in the end, it had a weight of 33 tons. It should be able, and it was able, to follow the Leopard 1, which was also a tank that was very well suited for atomic war. So both vehicles had, in general, the tendency, the concept to protect the whole crew, which are three people in this, with the gunner, the commander, and the driver. And originally it was 7 people, but after...
So 7 additional people to the 3 crewmen?
Yeah, Panzergrenadiers.
7
Panzergrenadiers. Okay. But after arming the vehicle with ATGM, so anti-tank guided missiles, they lost one Panzergrenadier because of space reasons. And in the end, this vehicle was well suited for combat, to follow the Leopard 1 in an atomic scenario, and also to fight against other APCs or weaker targets, not combat tanks. But with its ETGM, at least at the end of the 70s, it was also able to fight with enemy tanks, of course.
So I read a bit on the Marder, and from what I remember, there was like during development, there was a bit of issue because there was some like an agreement with the United States, like if the Germans develop an APCR, it should be in combination with the Americans, but the Americans wanted a fully amphibious vehicle, but the Marder isn't, as far as I know.
As far as I know, it isn't.
It can swim, but yeah. It's not like it's self-propelled.
Not for amphibious operations. Yeah, I think that's what the Americans had in mind with an invasion at the beach
or river crossing.
But this is, of course, able to cross a river, because this was very important in World War II and would be, of course, very important in a Cold War. When the Cold War would become hot, there was a planned maneuver warfare, no matter if there were atomic bombs or not, at least in the West German mindset.
I mean, of course, you must have Bewegungskrieg, as it's not German.
It's not German, yeah. They tried to solve everything, no matter if it's an atomic war or not. You have to have maneuver warfare. And so, of course, this vehicle was also able to drive through rivers and to dive through rivers. Interesting about this is also its successor, which was never produced in a series. You can see it in two museums in Germany, in the Panzermuseum Münster and in the WTS. This is the Marder 2.
Oh, I think I only know it from Red Dragon.
Yeah, it's...
It's in Münster?
Yeah, and Münster should be a Marder 2, as far as I know.
I may have missed it. I know there were a lot of Marders in Münster, but at that point I was quite ignorant when I rushed through that.
But there are only prototypes available, and this was the successor of this in the 1980s, and it was bigger and had also a bigger gun. And originally it was planned that the Panzergrenadiers could stay inside for 24 hours. Has something to do with atomic war, yeah, to stay inside. Was also a concept in the so-called main battle tank 70, a German-American
money hole,
yeah, but also quite important for future tank designs like Leopard 2 and M1 Abrams. And they also had the concept that the crew should stay inside quite long. I have even heard they had a toilet in there. I don't know if this is true. They have no toilet. And the Marder 2 also has this concept that the crew can stay very long inside the vehicle to survive an atomic war with all the radiation and so on.
Okay, excellent. Mm-hmm. So anything else on the Marder, or should we head to the BMP already?
We should head to the BMP because it will look like a little bit different, I think.
Okay. See you there. And we are back at the BMP-2.
Yeah, and fun thing is, we just talked about the Marder, and if you look at the BMP, it looks quite different, especially it's much smaller, only 14 tons. But in a way, it's the same concept. So you see, there are one concept, or let's say one problem to be solved, but the solutions are quite different, in some way at least. And here it's quite smaller. One of the reasons is it's the successor of the BMP-1. And the BMP-1, the main difference, I think, is the armament. There are some other differences, like a little bit the armor and the placement of the commander and the turret in this vehicle, while in the BMP-1 it was in the hull, which was not so good. Also, you see a little bit of tradition, if you remember, at the T-34. Which also had a commander which was not so favored in the position. They had to done everything.
Yeah, I had to also be the gunner.
So also a little bit turret issues with the commander in its position. But this was solved with BMP-2, who was now the commander was sitting in the turret. And of course the armament, which was on the BMP-2, a 30mm autocannon. And the thinking about changing the armament was already at the end of 60s, because the BMP-1 had a 73mm smoothbore cannon, which was especially suited against tanks. Yeah, smoothbore, but with a heat, a little bit strange, fin stabilized, but that didn't work very well. So after several hundreds of meters, one say 400, other say 600, the projectile lost aiming. So it was not really well fitting. And so the Soviet designers were already thinking about the 30mm autocannon. And in 1973, there was one of the last great tank battles in the 20th century, in the so-called Yom Kippur War. And there the BMP-1 also showed some disadvantages, especially with the armament, because the BMP-1 originally had as I said, the smoothbore cannon and the 83 ATGM. And also this rocket was not really well in precision. And so they changed it to the 30 millimeter autocannon, and they also changed the rockets on the vehicle, 84 and 85. As I said, the commander seat and a little bit the armor, not much, only in shape more or less. And so in the end, this was the BMP-2, which proved to be much more sufficient in Afghanistan, where 30 millimeter autocannon could be put at higher angles in the mountains and so on.
If I remember correctly from a chieftain talk he gave recently, he noted that the 30 millimeter autocannon was chosen to suppress ATGM crews, anti-tank guided missile crews, mostly because, I mean, you have a high rate of fire, better for suppression than the smoothbore gun.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the smoothbore gun theoretically had a range with the HE projectile, I read 1,600 meters, which is quite sufficient, but it's right, the rate of fire is too low. So you have too much brakes in it.
So this is basically now an armament against light vehicles and infantry mainly, and before it was infantry and also medium tanks to a certain degree, but with limited capabilities.
Yeah, but I would say the most decisive thing about the armor, much more when it comes to the BMP than to the Marder, is about the atomic war. Because, yeah, of course, armor will help against atomic radiation and fallout and so on. Also artillery, conventional artillery, of course. And so I think this skin is more or less to protect the soldiers against this than against tank cannons or armor piercing everything, because it's very thin. I think maximum machine gun also, or small caliber grenades also. And in the end, it's a little bit the same with the Marder, but the Marder is also against more heavy grenades armored. So that's the difference, I think, where the weight is coming from. And don't forget the space of the crew and the soldiers in the back, the Panzergrenadiers, when it comes to the Germans. Because this vehicle carried even more soldiers than the Marder, although it has only half of the weight.
So the crew to ton ratio is
yeah,
it's way better here.
Actually, it is. Yeah. Actually, it is.
So that's way better if you have a big family and a small income. But if you can you afford it, you can take out the Marder, I guess.
The vehicle you see here was used by the East German Army, by the National People's Army, NVA in German. And there were only, I think, 24 or so, 23, not that much. And they were used together with the T-72s. You can see maybe the tank in the background. Yeah. And this was also a tank that was not so common in the East German Army. Mostly there were BMP-1 and T-55. So this was a more modern tank, APC, at the end of Cold War.
Doesn't this have this a rather nasty nickname in the NVA? Kotzkübel?
Yeah, but this counts for a lot of APCs.
Okay, yeah. So basically what I heard at Stahl auf der Heide, the event of the Panzermuseum Munster, is that it was called Kotzkübel, which means puke bucket. And because, well, inside it's rather shaky. And I think one person expressed it in a way, this is one way to get out the infantry into the open fire, because they rather get outside into the fire then stay inside the driving vehicle, although I'm not
because
sure
it's
if this holds
also
up.
Very cramped.
Yeah.
But you have one vehicle in the East German Army, I think it's the BTR-50 or so, which is very long, and this was really hell for the crew inside and especially for the soldiers in the back, because it was very long, and when they drove in a terrain which was difficult, they had high angles vehicle, and then
bonk. Yeah.
So. So, and this is also called Kotzkübel, and I think nearly every tank or APC in the NVA was called Eisenschwein. At least I heard this.
Iron pig,
yeah. At least I heard this word for everything that was made of steel and had a track also. But it was mostly used to be fair for tanks, I think.
Okay. Yeah. Anything else to add here?
No, but just to say one thing which really differs from the Marder is that those vehicles were really used very widely in combat all over the world. So in the wars.
And it proved more or less effective.
Yeah, more or less. Who knows, you know?
Yeah,
because
I mean, the problem
very
is
complex scenarios.
Yeah, the problem is with Soviet equipment. Oftentimes it was used by third or second rate armies, and so it's sometimes the equipment might be judged by wrong criteria because how well others adapted or were able to enforce Soviet doctrine. Because I think Soviet doctrine was also, I mean, I have a video with Tech Era on this, was very mathematical and in a way done.
Yeah, it was.
That is likely not really suited for certain countries, let's put it that way.
Yeah, and also those vehicles were mostly used in wars. It was designed for World War III, for atomic conflict, and for a war in masses.
Yeah. Yeah,
where losses had to be counted, while other vehicles, mostly produced by Western countries, are in such conflicts at least with the aim to have no losses.
Yeah.
You know? And I think, I don't know if this was really a calculation behind this vehicle, which was quite cheap, of course, because it's light.
Okay. So, by the way, these vehicles are outside here at the Military History Museum in Dresden, and you can walk around here. So they are openly not like in a depot, so you can take a closer look yourself if you want, during opening hours.
And some of the technologies that were used in this vehicle, you can see at the end of 2022 in our museum, because we are doing a great exhibition on the technology of Cold War.
Guess who is doing it?
Yes.
So big thank you, Jens. And thank you to the Military History Museum of the Bundeswehr in Dresden. Thank you to all my Patreon subscribers and supporters for making trips like this possible. Thank you for watching and see you next time.
Bye.